This section is a review of the properties of exponents and then logarithms. As I've mentioned before, there's not a lot of algebra in this course, but exponent and logs are going to come up all the time, so it's important that you're pretty comfortable with them. If you're not sure if you need this review, what I'll suggest is the following. Take the quizzes that have interspersed throughout these videos, and if the quizzes, you can do them without any problem, then there's no need to watch the video. But if the quizzes are a little bit confusing or you want to, or you're uncertain about a topic, then go back and watch the videos that came right before that quiz. So let's get started, and we'll begin by thinking about exponents. So we'll start by thinking about properties of exponents. And the starting point is to think about what exponents mean anyway. So an exponent, as you probably know, means successive multiplication. So for example, 3 raised to the 4th power means we take 3 and multiply it by itself 4 times. So 3 to the 4th is 3 times 3 times 3 times 3, which in this case would be, let's see, 3 times 3 is 9, 3 times 3 is 9, 9 times 9 is 81. Okay. So as long as you remember the definition of an exponent, its successive multiplication, everything else follows pretty quickly. So what if we had something like 3 to the 4 times 3 to the 2, 3 squared? Well, 3 to the 4, what's that? That's 3 times 3 times 3 times 3. That's what exponent means, multiply by itself 4 times. 3 squared means multiply by itself 2 times, 1, 2. So we can see, well, we can just count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this is 3 to the 6. And so we see 3 to the 4, 3 to the 2 is equal to 3 to the 4 plus 2, which is how we got 3 to the 6. If you multiply 3 by itself 4 times and then 3 by itself 2 times and multiply those together, that's the same as multiplying 3 by itself 6 times. So that's our first property or rule for exponents. It says that x to the a times x to the b is x to the a plus b. That's important. So I'll put that in a purple box. All right. So what if instead of having 3 to the 4 times 3 to the 2, we had 3 to the 4 divided by 3 to the 2? So, in other words, what if we had this? 3 to the 4 over 3 to the 2. Well, 3 to the 4 is 3 times 3 times 3 times 3. 3 to the 2, what's that? 3 times 3. So we can cancel, and we're left with 3 times 3, which is 3 squared. And so what happened is we had 4 threes up here, 2 threes down here. The downstairs threes canceled 2 of the upstairs 3, leaving us with 2. So in other words, 3 to the 4 over 3 to the 2 is 3 to the 4 minus 2, which is how we got 3 to the 2. And that gives us another general property. X to the a, x to the b is x to the a minus b. And it follows from this that, say, 1 over x to the b is the same thing as x to the minus b. So that's another important property. This analysis tells us what negative exponents should mean. there are a number of ways to see that. Maybe one way is as follows. Suppose we have, I don't know, 3 to the 5 over 3 to the 7. Why did I choose such big numbers? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So 5 cancel. And I'm left with 1 over 3 to the 2. But over here, if we use this rule, this would be 3 to the 5 minus 7, which is 3 to the minus 2. So there are a number of different ways to convince yourself that this makes sense. The bottom line is that a number raised to a negative exponent is the same as 1 over a number raised to that exponent. All right, so we have these two general rules for exponents, and these follow directly from the definition of exponentiation as successive multiplication. Let's consider two important special cases. So first, what might 3 to the first power equal? So a couple ways to think about this. Suppose I did this, 3 to the 3 over 3 to the 2. That's 3 times 3 times 3 over 3 times 3. And that's just 3, right? Those cancel, I'm left with 3. I could also use this rule. This is 3 to the 3 minus 2, which is 3 to the 1. So 3 to the 1 is just 3. And that kind of makes sense, right? 3 multiplied by itself 1 times seems like that you'll be left with 3. So that's a general general thing, that a number, any non-zero number, raised to the first power just gives you that number back. All right, one more to think about, and that's, what about 3 to the 0? What should that equal? Well, let's do something similar to what I did here. I'm going to do, say, 3 squared over 3 squared. So, well, I don't even need to multiply this out. That's 1, because I have the same thing at the top and the bottom. But I could also write this using this. This is 3 to the 2 minus 2. 2 minus 2 is 0. So aha, this shows us that 3 to the 0 is 1. And this is one that sometimes trips people up. There's a sense 3 multiplied by itself 0 times, what should that be? Kind of feels like it should be 0, and there's a case to be made for it. But a number raised to the 0 power is defined to be 1, and the reason is that then it preserves these nice rules. The bottom line is x to the 0 equals 1, and that's true as long as x is not equal 0. Last but not least, let's think about square roots and exponents. So suppose I have something like the square root of 3. And I want to know, how can I think about that? And can I write that as an exponent? So let's think about what the square root of 3 means. By definition, the square root of 3 is a number which, if I multiply it by itself, square root of 3 times square root of 3, I get 3 back. We saw just a moment ago that 3 is really 3 to the 1. So I claim that square root 3 has to be 3 to the half. Why? Because the exponent rule says I would add these. 3 to the half plus a half equals 3 to the 1. So the general rule is that square root of x is x to the half. And you can generalize this by a very similar argument that the nth root of x is x to the 1 over n. So those are the basic properties of exponents. Take a moment to practice them, try them out in the next couple quizzes to make sure that you see how all this works, and then we'll move on and think about logarithms.